So, welcome everybody. Thank you so much for attending. We're here to talk about digital accessibility in the context of obviously what's the current political climate, also what's going on here at Princeton University, some of the great things that we're doing. And I am Damian, Sian. I'm the Senior Web Accessibility Advisor here in the User Experience Office. I have two of my colleagues with me to participate in the discussion afterward. Mary Albert, the Director of User Experience, and Charlie Kreisberg, the Senior User Experience Advisor. Good, next slide. Thank you for that. So today, we'll talk a little bit about the format and some of the topics I want to discuss today. So this is definitely a seminar, not a lecture. So if anything that piques your interest, let's stop and talk about it. And then obviously, I only want to take about 25 minutes of me discussing the topics and then for us to have a conversation. So to do that, to facilitate that, I want to go over what digital accessibility means as opposed to physical accessibility. Then we'll talk about some of the federal institutions that protect people with disabilities in their access of digital content. And then kind of what's the current status of that, and then what we'll speculate about some things that are in the future. So first, we'll start off with the definition. So accessible websites, well, this is going off the edge here a little bit, isn't it? That's unfortunate, so I'll read a lot. Accessible websites don't require people to see, hear, or use a standard mouse in order to access the information, and that's a definition from the World Health Organization. So as people who create digital content, we can't rely on any sensory, physical, or cognitive ability of the user who's interacting with that content. Especially if that information is tied to accessing the products or services of an institution. Okay? When we do that, when we present that kind of a barrier, we're discriminating against people, and there are legal protections for folks to have recourse. Okay, next slide, please. So, a more technical understanding of digital accessibility would be the means by which people with disabilities can perceive, operate, understand, navigate, and use the web to access the digital content. And that's by the World Wide Web Consortium. So the W3C, some of the things that we're familiar with in that. So those would be the technical requirements. How do we make digital content accessible? And if you're looking at some of the cards that I was able to give out to folks here, you'll see some of those requirements listed out in text format. Okay. Next slide, please. So at its heart, digital accessibility is about providing equity. And we have a slide here that demonstrates equitable use. And the slide is a demonstration of, a sliding electric door is an example of equitable use because everyone can enjoy it. The user isn't stigmatized to have to use it. So provide the same means of use for all users, identical whenever possible, equivalent when not, thus avoiding segregating and stigmatizing any user. And that's the first principle of universal design. That's one of the guiding frameworks of accessibility that we use. A door that was designed for someone in a wheelchair is now a great experience for somebody pushing a shopping cart or a stroller or having a conversation to walk through the door. Everyone gets the same uses out of that. And if we design our content accessibly, we do the same thing. We've reduced the barriers for people with disabilities to access the content, and we've also made it stronger for everyone else. So, digital accessibility recognizes that people are not broken or defective, that our technology is. So if we look at the points of human-computer interaction, when someone is blocked from achieving their objectives and their goals, that's where the disability occurs in context to digital accessibility. We've presented a barrier, that's when we've disabled somebody. So the technology is what needs to be remediated, not human beings, not people. Next slide, please. The core of a digital accessibility is a way for us as people who develop content, who maybe purchase digital services for a vendor, it's an actionable and a referenceable standard for us to adhere to. It's a set of guidelines. And the WCAG, it's called the WCAG. Okay? The World Wide Web Consortium produces that referenceable standard for us to achieve. And it's called the WCAG, Web Content Accessibility Guidelines. And if you're looking at the card that I gave you guys, that references the 11 most common mistakes that I've seen as a professional in the industry about people entering content into a website of yours. There are 38 of those criteria to meet a level AA standard. So level AA would assume all of A, and then the second level of AA. At Princeton, we are aiming for level AA compliance, which is the industry standard when you talk about providing equal and inclusive access to people in a digital environment. So I'm not going to go over all 38 of those. There's a lot. It's a whole industry. But I'll go over the four guiding principles. So it spells out the word core. So perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. And perceivable is probably the thing that people recognize the most, putting alternative text descriptions on an image. So describing an image to somebody so a screen reader can access it. And that goes to one of the core principles too, is modality. So having text present for us to read can also be converted into synthesized speech through a screen reader. And then things like color contrast, making sure that things are distinguishable foreground and background for people with low vision. Operability, we want to make sure every single thing on a digital environment can be accessed with a keyboard. It doesn't rely on someone's motor skills or even having a hand to operate a mouse. Okay. Understandable, we try to make things operate and behave in predictable ways, and so it's navigable. And robust is one of the most elusive. There's only two requirements under robust. And it asks us to make sure our code and our content is designed in a way that can be picked up by assistive technologies today, and those are the future. So when we have something like a wearable device or virtual reality, the day that you make those devices and the content within the devices required to participate in a class, for example, you must make that accessible in some format. So again, Princeton University is aiming for double A. So it's 38 success criteria on that. Next slide, please. So what's in scope? When I say digital accessibility, that could be anything you plug in, right? It's a lot to put a scope on. What we in the industry and what the federal government have determined to be in scope would be information communication technology, ICT. And I've given a pretty glib understanding of what that would mean here in two major buckets, software and hardware. So all the software, right? All the hardware. Email, social media, websites, internet, apps on your phone, videos, multimedia, animations, documents. Yes, yes, yes. Everything inside your classroom, yes. Hardware, mobile, we talked about the wearables, the virtual reality of the future, desktops, tablets, all these things are within the scope of ICT. And they all have requirements that we can to meet their mostly objective and some subjective requirements in that regard. It will help us make that accessible and inclusive to people with all abilities. Next. So that was the overview of what we're now going to call ICT accessibility. I'm not going to call it digital accessibility. I don't lead off with that because it's like a mouthful, and I am trying to indoctrinate people into this. And I want to do it gradually, not just call it ICT accessibility in the presentation title. But from now on, we will call it ICT access. Okay? So, and I'm not here to give a civics lesson. I think you guys are very smart people. right? I wanted to talk about the topic of the new administration and the overall political climate as one whole in regards to the three branches of our government. So, in the legislative branch, we have congressional laws. So who here has heard of the Americans with Disabilities Act? Okay, everybody knows. And you all enjoyed it in some fashion to get here today. Curb cuts and sidewalks, reserved parking spaces, different types of bathrooms that accommodate different needs. ADA from our Congress, okay? Those laws are enacted or enforced by the executive branch, right? So the Department of Justice and the Department of Education are the two things we're going to talk about the most today, because they have the most bearing on ICT access. And the judiciary, and my words are flying off the screen here. So the Supreme Court and the federal courts. The majority of action that's happened in ICT access has happened within federal courts. Okay, they point to the congressional law, the legislation, and they're enforced by the agencies. So it's an environment that's potentially affected. Let's see if I have. Next slide. So when we talk about civil rights legislation, these are the biggest pieces. Starting off in the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, with Sections 504 and Sections 508. Section 504 is very applicable within the university space. We actually have a 504 coordinator here. And I'm sorry, this is Sean Maxim of the Office of Diversity and Inclusion. And I didn't get to introduce Liz Erickson, Office of Disability Services. So very connected to Section 504. IDEA. This kind of got a lot of popularity in the DeVos hearing. She didn't know what it was. Interesting. Extremely important. Mostly affects public schools, IEPs, individual education plans. So the ADA, the most popular, celebrated its 25th anniversary recently. And it's been so instrumental in giving people access both in the physical built environment and then in the digital space as well. Telecommunications Acts, CDAA, both kind of the same thing in media and broadcast. And little known, ACA. Section 1557 demanded that all communications be accessible basically per 3-in-1 here. Yeah, little known facts, gone, right? So with the exception of that one, right, I don't think any of these are really in jeopardy. They were passed through a bipartisan effort, and it's unlikely, in my opinion, that they will be overturned or repealed. There may be some weakening. Okay, so recently there was a bill that was introduced to eliminate or lessen the effect of drive-by lawsuits. Okay, there are some folks, I mean, there are thousands of sites that are being sued, and there was legislation that was attempted to be passed that would say, we're not going to allow these drive-by lawsuits to occur, kind of taking the power out of people's ability to file complaints and go to federal court over it. It was, didn't go through, but not to say that it won't come up again or be a problem. Okay, next. So, the Rehabilitation Act and the ADA are the most appropriate, or the biggest pieces of this puzzle of what could happen right now. Section 504 says that accommodations are available for any federal agency, or any agency or institution that receives federal funds. That's what would grant students the right here to request accommodations in the physical space, or even in the, they can request accommodations in the digital space as well. Section 508 guarantees ICT access, okay, for federal agencies, but there are no direct provisions that also extend out to organizations that receive federal funds. Recently, as of January 18th, there was an update to Section 508 to the IT Access Board. Basically, all it did was point to the standard to be WCAG 2.0 and blah, blah, blah. It didn't go so far as to say institutions that receive federal funds also have to make all their ICT accessible. So we have a lot of protections, but it's not all the way there. There's not enough regulation to say today that as a student who goes here, I have to have inclusive access, not accommodation access. And then we have the ADA. I'm going to stand over here. ADA Title II and Title III are the most appropriate to the topic of digital accessibility or ICT accessibility. Title II guarantees public access to physical spaces, does not grant or does not enforce ICT access in public spaces. And Title III, so this is the most promising piece here because it does mandate that accessibility is applicable to private institutions. Okay, so that would mean that the buildings that they create, the physical spaces they create, will have to be accessible to people of all abilities. It doesn't go so far as to directly implicate that websites are part of those, their access to products and services. It doesn't specifically state that in the law. So both in 2010, there was an advance notice of proposed rulemaking for the Rehabilitation Act and for the ADA. We were expecting that by 2018, that line would be drawn in the sand, that this would be the only thing that we would need in the industry to say, do you have a website? It has to be made accessible. It has to be made accessible to WCAG 2.0 by this date, if you're this type of organization. It's still pending. It's been pending for 7 years now. My speculation is that it will continue to be pending for the next 4 years, or the next 8 years, however long. We had such hope in the industry that we finally had that smoking gun, that line in the sand, that said, yes, you do. Because people ask us, do I have to make that accessible? Do I have to make that accessible? Do I have to make that accessible? And we say, yes, because, and then we go to a consent decree from the Department of Justice. We go from a letter of interest, or a dear colleague letter, that points to these things as in the future. And that's enough of a stick for a lot of people to get in line. We don't have a clear understanding, and it's not likely that we're going to get it, especially in today's world. economic nationalism and deregulation. It's kind of the stated purpose of the new administration. Executive order mandates that any new regulation has two to go away before the new one comes in. Now, the Section 508 refresh had a launch date of January 18th, 2017. So they're only applicable to a 60-day waiting period, so March 20th is when we can expect that, which is great. But it doesn't really get us all the way there. And now that pending regulation from the Department of Justice, that's just sitting there, just waiting, we're so close. With that kind of language, this kind of executive order, and this kind of action being taken by the highest level, I don't see it happening. Next. So at the Conservative Political Action Committee, or conference, Steve Bannon made it also very clear, some more of the, so during the campaign there's a lot of things flying back and forth, right? How do you know which things are true, which things they really believe in, and you know, what's really going to happen? So I think this is probably the most telling thing that came out of that conference. And this is the deconstruction of the administrative state. So his quote is, the way progressive left runs is they can't get it passed, they're just going to put in some kind of regulation in an agency. That's going to be deconstructed. If you look at these cabinet appointees that were selected, it was for that reason of deconstruction. That's a deconstruction, I think. Her quote, government really sucks, it doesn't matter which party is in control. Didn't deny that she said that at the confirmation hearing, and it seemed to support it even more. So, what can the Department of Education mean if it were significantly defunded, if the power were stripped away from it, if the leadership of it doesn't believe that the federal government has any business telling anyone what to do? So, consistently the Department of Education, via the Office of Civil Rights, has intervened on behalf of plaintiffs, on behalf of students, citing Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act and Title II of the ADA. You could file a complaint, they would get involved, they would take action. Things would change. Since 2010, there's been the needle has moved since 2010. I fear right now it's stopped, and it could possibly retrograde. I don't know, under this leadership, what protections will be, if a student with a disability has a problem, especially in ICT access, they're going to really move the needle any further under this leadership. She's also in favor of pulling resources away from public schools and preferring voucher programs. There are instances documented in those voucher programs you are asked to sign away your IDEA rights. So the IDEA is, what she didn't know, I'll tell you, it's the Individual Disabilities Education Act. That in order to participate in moving from your public school to the voucher program, you can sign away your rights in the back. Next.
Sorry, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, please.
Apropos of what you said before about the proposed rules change under the ADA.
Yes.
If that were to pass, then that would cover the space, essentially, right? Because then you would, institutions would be obligated to ensure that access, even regardless of their sort of educational institution status.
Okay. Yes, if that were to go through, we've been waiting for it for so long, and we've been using it as our kind of stick, like, better watch out, 2018, they said, they're going to do this thing, and now, we just significantly lost the power of that threat of what's going on right now.
Can you elaborate what you mean by signing away rights? Because I know that, like, for an IEP to take place, sure, then the school system is responsible for the education and welfare of the, whatever child is in question. And so does that mean that
the school system changes that regard to the private school?
Right. So then that private school would.
They're absolving of their stuff like that.
They just don't have any responsibility for the child.
I think you don't have the IEP through, I'm not 100% sure, but I think you don't have the IEP through your district anymore. Like, if you just go to that private school as if you were, like, some people, I have some with special needs, some people take their kids out of district and send them to a school that they choose, that the school doesn't choose, and then that parent kind of loses whatever benefits were from that school district. They're paying for the education for that child, and so forth, and they don't have any rights anymore to have an IEP from the district and so forth like that. I think it's sort of similar.
So essentially there's no IEP?
I think so, and unless the school you're going to may have some sort of IEP type of thing, but not. And right now you can go out of district. My son goes out of district. It's paid for by the township. We have an IEP through the township even though he's out of district.
My wife is a middle school teacher. And she has binders, basically. She has one binder for 504 and one binder for IEP. And she tried to explain this to me in detail last night. I didn't really catch it. I'm sorry.
It's complicated.
She gave me a very good answer. I was like, it's a lot of stuff that you do. I'm sorry. I don't know. So I don't have a better answer for you. So what is, I have a quote here from Jeff Sessions. Speaking about IDEA, so we've created a complex system of federal regulations and laws that have created lawsuit after lawsuit, special treatment. Okay, and that word worries me when people say special treatment. It seems to me that there's an opposition to equity, in it that you're giving special and preferential treatment to people who are underrepresented and powerless. And to me, that's what equity would be. We can't have equality without equity. And language like that, special treatment, is worrisome to me. For certain children that are a big factor in accelerating the decline of civility and discipline in classrooms all over America. Oh, and I say that very sincerely. So, to punctuate that, he really meant that. To say that inclusive classrooms are destroying civility and discipline in classrooms all over America. That's his view on it.
It's a very interesting quote in the context of Princeton School District and what's been going on most recently with the charter school conversation.
So, as the leader of the Department of Justice and the Office of Civil Rights within the Department of Justice, the DOJ has consistently sided with plaintiffs in federal courts through consent decrees and letters of interest. They've also taken litigation themselves, so it'll be United States versus whomever. Okay, so if you file a complaint to the DOJ, they will get involved and they will intervene on your behalf, mostly in the space of Title III, as far as the ICT and accessibility. The most notable case there was Target, the National Federation for the Blind versus Target. There was an online sale. The only way that you can get to this online sale, or the sale ever, so there's no access to it in physical store. You can only get to it online. It was inaccessible. NFB saw it, and they sued them. Target went and fought back and said, the ADA is written for the physical space. That's the digital space. Doesn't apply. That's where the Department of Justice got involved. And that was the first consent decree that really told us in the industry that it's coming. It's finally coming. And they said, now, you misread the intent of the ADA. The intent of the ADA is to give access to products and services. How you get there is really incidental. Unfortunate business here, unfortunate part of it, they got extremely granular in their definition of physical spaces. Laundromats, movie theaters. They should have left it far more wide open, because then that would have been easier for us to say, No, obviously it's a website. If I can only apply to your institution through a website, if I can, or one of the ways, the easiest ways for me to apply is through online, or the only way I can receive funds from you is if I submit a form online. You're putting a huge barrier to my access, and that's discrimination per Title III of the ADA. It's not specifically called out. So people are still fighting. There's thousands of lawsuits that are going out. Which is another part of, we're looking for that clarity, so we don't have to have all these lawsuits. I mean, we talk about saving money. You know, the thousands of suits that go through, it could be very easily solved by just one new regulation. Or it's not even a new regulation, it's just a clarification of the existing regulation. And then, so that's the executive branch, and then we go into the judicial. So here, Neil Gorsuch? So in a case that he tried in the 10th Circuit, he stated that the Rehabilitation Act does not seek to turn employers into safety net providers who cannot work. So he doesn't have a huge track record in disability rights, but the ones that he does have, he sided with the, he's on the right, he's on the conservative side of these things. He's siding with the institution, the company that has kind of an undue burden to present fair and equal access to people with disabilities. So right now there's obviously one Supreme Court justice.
What was the case that issued?
So, Huang versus Kansas State University. Someone with a disability wanted to have some of their work for a short. So this person had been employed for 15 years, and they wanted a temporary disability that they wanted to work from home for some time, and they were denied that access. So they sued, and I believe that they lost. As far as the outcome, I'm not sure. But if he's looking at his statement, I'm assuming. So what do they have right now? He also had in addition to the Rehabilitation Act, he also had an unfavorable ruling for IDEA as well, finding for the school, not the plaintiff. So we have one Supreme Court justice definite, and everyone should do a silent prayer for Ruth Bader Ginsburg right now, that we don't have any more. But that basically puts back to the 5-4 that was there before, right? So Scalia was conservative, he was gone, and now we're putting another conservative there. So back to the 5-4 split. It's a lifetime appointment. Okay. And then what else in the court system? Next, federal judges. So Trump is sent to inherit 103 of the vacant federal judgeships. That's twice as many, almost twice as many as Obama got from George Bush. So. Those are also lifetime appointees. And so we're talking about possible a generation of conservative federal judges leading all the way up into the Supreme Court as well. Okay, so that could be that kind of a substantial impact on people because they, without the clarification of the law of ADA and Rehabilitation Act, they seek satisfaction in the courts. Okay. So since 2010, there's been a huge spike in those cases. So 2010 is when the Rehabilitation Act and the ADA said they're going to have an advance notice of proposed rulemaking in 2018. Court cases spiked. Now they're what will happen at this point? I don't know. My speculation goggles are negative. I guess they're not rosy. So the summary, the executive branch, if I were to give you speculations as an industry professional, I would speculate there could be a continued inaction on strict regular regulations on Title III of the ADA applying specifically to ICT access. I'd also say that the protection that was afforded by the Department of Education, Department of Justice will start ticking backward. That they won't take the complaints to trial, and that they won't intervene as much or as frequently in current trials. Legislation, that drive-by thing, that might come back and rear its head again, kind of limiting the power of plaintiffs in legal actions in federal courts. And then the judicial, obviously, it could be that we would see, with a larger percentage of conservative judges less judgments been in the favor of people with disabilities, especially in ICT access. Next. So what is Princeton going to do about it? So I can tell you safely that Princeton's commitment to ICT access would extend beyond federal regulation and this administration, any administration. This university has a commitment to diversity and inclusion, and we're here to honor that, and that's going to be through, you'll see that in action through the information communication technology. Our group in the USO, we're offering free training in different ways. You can, any student, faculty, or staff can sign up for their free training in the learning management system. We're also building a certification program from an independent group called the IAAP, International Association of Accessibility Professionals. We'll be proctoring that certification exam here at the school as well. Outreach, so we're working closely with the Commission for the Blind and Visually Impaired. They're actually attending all of our trainings for the rest of the year. So after I deliver my spiel, they come out and they give a panel discussion and live demonstration of using assistive technologies, and they have a table full of their technologies, and we are working to find employment opportunities with them to do usability testing on sites here in the school too. This is very exciting. Heaven Gurma will be speaking here on April 24th, so we're going to be celebrating Global Accessibility Awareness Day on April 24th through the Office of Diversity and Inclusion. She will be our keynote speaker. So if you're not familiar with Heaven, Heaven is a recent graduate of Harvard Law School, a disability rights advocate lawyer, an avid sports enthusiast, and she's deafblind. So she'll be here speaking to us on the topic of having information communication technology accessibility in higher education. It's really special. Even more special, I think, is that I presented a Tiger Challenge, or we presented a Tiger Challenge to the Keller Center of Engineering to produce an assistive technology for her, and they took it. And they're gonna provide her the ability, there's some kind of wearable technology, we don't know yet, because they just, it's in words right now, to get audience feedback. So when you have people who are deafblind, they do tactile sign language, and they have a way to indicate that they're interested in what you're saying, or disinterested, or whatever. It's called back channeling. So we're trying to give that to her tactically, yeah, tactically, through haptics, on some kind of wearable technology on her. So they'll be presenting their final that day. So that's a little nerve-wracking, but you know, the students here are amazing. So I'm like, it's Princeton, right? We're gonna do something amazing. And the services. So we are working on making all of the ICT here accessible. The main website of the university is being redesigned as we speak. It is being designed with accessibility in mind. Okay. We're going to be offering usability testing through the New Jersey Commission for the Blind, and obviously consultation for our department as well. So if you were to use one of our approved Drupal sites, for example, there's accessibility built into that. And if you utilize these techniques, the content that you enter into will be accessible as well. And you can come to the training and learn how to do that work more in detail. And that's my spiel. I don't know where we're at with time.
Victoria.
So we have 20 minutes, no, 10.
It took that much time. 50 minutes long?
Yeah, sorry, I spoke for a lot longer than I thought I would. So this is the part where we have our open conversation, and
are there ways to incentivize institutions to comply with I guess these guidelines in a way that, you know, from their mind it's like, oh, this is also beneficial for us to do, because you have to sell it to them, you know, and that might be a way to get around having to deal with all of the mess that's going on in government right now.
So we have carrots and sticks. The stick would be, let's, oh, I guess both of our carrots. Let's avoid lawsuits. Mm-hmm. There have been advocacy groups out there that have been making very, very pointed legal actions just to do that. So National Federation for the Blind, National Federation for the Deaf, two of those groups that have said, mm-hmm. you know, we can have a conversation, or you can just take care of this. And the conversation would be in court. The other parts are, if you sign with content with accessibility in mind, you get superior search engine results, you get superior page load time, you get superior connectivity to future technology. Okay, so it makes it lighter, stronger, and more meaningful to make our content accessible to people with disabilities. Okay. Especially if we could, if we can convert the visual presentation into anything else. Google is blind and has a billion friends. Right? Search engines, when they look at a site, have no understanding of color and images. We provide that to them. We're giving taxonomy to the Internet of Things. We're increasing the value of the site. What it's hard for me is to quantify it and say, you will receive this much return on investment for doing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's their mindset. So.
It is. Yes, it is. I come from the corporate world, and that was the first thing they ask. You want 20% more time, what do I get out of that? I say,
you know, altruism. Like upfront costs. Yeah.
Or fixed costs. Yes, sir.
With regard to the thing you just mentioned of Google's blind and accessibility friends, as more advanced machine learning techniques and algorithms and stuff like that come about that can start to recognize and interpret images and audio and things of that nature and be able to convert from one mode of communication to another just by pure learning, how much longer is the issue of web designers being burdened to make their content accessible for it to remain relevant?
Right.
Are we like close to a tipping point, or are we still a long ways off?
And the privacy and security considerations in moving into that.
Sure. That's great. PII is a good point of that. And then what I find when people recruit for this kind of work, they're not finding a lot of talent out there. It's unfortunate that we have to consider accessibility as like another layer of functional requirements on design. That it's not built in, that it's not readily known. When I talk to people, at conferences, and when I speak to groups, and when I go into new organizations, what I find is that people are not aware of the concept of making things accessible. And it's not been built into the core HTML design standards, right? So if you, and not everyone checks for validation, right? So if I was a web designer, I would probably run through the HTML validator before I publish anything. There's no demand that you have to do that, but you should do it. What I would like to see is more accessibility features built into that validation up front. There's no good argument to say, I can't spend the time to do it right. But that, what we see in the industries, in corporate America, they're frequently saying that we have to get this released by this date, doesn't matter what. There's nothing that can stand in between us getting this launch. And I could say, you're in violation, you have these defects. So what we end up doing is, there's a lot of negotiation, unfortunately. So one of my tactics is to say, we'll put it into a backlog, we'll have a documented audit trail so we can prioritize these defects along with your other user stories and development. It's about as good as I can get.
Are you thinking that through machine learning, basically we don't need to do these things because the machine
perhaps
will be able to do the interpretations?
I mean, perhaps at some point it'll get to the point where we won't have to do anything.
Yeah.
Maybe a little shorter term, the burden will be lessened.
Mm-hmm.
That's a really interesting idea. I hadn't thought about that.
So the Blackboard Ally, there's been some movement on that. So Blackboard is a company that we use here at the university. They purchased a company called Ally. And Ally does have a lot of machine learning where they are trying to convert documents. So a syllabus, for example, goes up into the Blackboard system inaccessibly, and then it can just immediately remediate without having to be, everyone wants a button, right? Push the button. Of course I push the button and said make it accessible. It took another 3 minutes to upload my PDF, right? Who wouldn't do that? And what I've seen, it looks really promising. I gave them a document that was made to break their system, and it only broke 33% of it, which is great. Because it's coming from a lot of understanding of what the common mistakes are, where machines look at something and pass it. So if I was designing something that would say, is there alternative text on an image, how do I know if it's meaningful or if it's gibberish? Right? They detected my gibberish in that. So I was bolstered by the fact that they did that. And, so there's machine learning opportunities.
So it's happening.
It's happening, yes, it is happening.
Isn't it true, am I right, that in Facebook, These captions that are now appearing on the videos are generated in real time through voice recognition.
There, so I'm involved in that as like a, like the page. People that I know are involved with it. Most of the comments in there are critiques about how it's working right now, but it's happening. Yes, YouTube has an automated captioning, for example.
Yeah.
There's a lot of like kind of spoof channels that say, you know, Facebook captioning fails, where they say really awful things when someone's speaking. So it's coming. It's way better than nothing, but it's not all the way there.
Yeah, I can sit in the bedroom at night and watch videos. Yeah, having to turn on the phone and getting in trouble.
I have a newborn baby, and my wife is trying to sleep, and I've got her, and I'm like, oh, cool, that's nice. I can watch the news.
You know, a funny local example of that not working on YouTube, it was Shirley Tillman, our former president, welcoming a freshman class, saying, welcome to Princeton, and YouTube automatically captioned as, welcome to prison.
So as a content maker and app developer in the healthcare space, it's really interesting when you talk about usability for people of a broad spectrum of capabilities, right?
Right.
And I think from my point of view, just, and I'm not in this space. I'm able-bodied, and everybody in my family is able-bodied. I just happen to fall into it, actually, literally as a communication myself, but. Listening to what you're talking about and dealing with the entire globe of and the entire spectrum of capability, it's really overwhelming. And you have finite resources.
Sure.
So I feel like you have to sort of, like, you know, from the ACA, right into the fourth grade level is sort of the, you know, the guideline that I use, but I can't accommodate every disability that's out there. You know, because we just don't have the money. Like, I can't serve the blind because it's a text-based product, you know. I wonder, like, how are we supposed to hear about building for diversity and inclusion when it's such a broad definition?
It is a broad definition. The WCAG, the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, is 30 access criteria, get us as far as we can. Okay. There is a AAA standard, which is really only people who go for AAA or like the people who wrote the AAA standard. But the AA standard, the starting success criteria, are meant to serve the needs of the sensory abilities, both sight and hearing, and the complete absolution of those. Okay, so, and for mobility impairment, and for cognitive impairment. Okay. The cognitive is really the hardest. You mentioned the writing for the fourth grade reading level. It's extremely hard to evaluate that. It's very heuristic. The Fleisch score, K, I've tripped those up on purpose by using text from Ulysses by James Joyce. It is incomprehensible to read that. If you're extremely brilliant, like, oh, it's really hard. It got a great score, because the language is plain, so it's not using verbose or complicated language, but it's really nonsensical when you put that paragraph together, but it got a great score. We have some work to do in a cognition area. But as far as making content accessible to people who are non-sighted, it's really the biggest audience that we serve. There's a lot of things that we can do for that. In fact, if you were to stick to those 11 points of those guidelines, you could meet the needs of most visual impairments, from full blindness to color blindness, low sightedness, cataract, coma, everyone we serve. They're actually, you know, one of the strongest groups that we can help, because it's the most difficult. In my opinion.
For the sight?
For the non-sighted, yes. So taking text and translating into synthesized speech, linearizing things, like tables, providing a semantic understanding to things like data visualization, graphs, charts, math. It's probably the most challenging things that we have to do, but they're completely doable, I'll assure you. I've built my career around doing this. I've dedicated the rest of my life to do this. It's very possible to do the work. And the WCAG is the strongest group that they serve as
people. I'm curious to hear about it. I mean, in the terms of, like, from when there's user-generated content, you know, that sort of, I mean, I just set it aside because I couldn't even imagine how to accommodate fully non-sighted people.
Yeah.
Partially, yeah, we have like to take that in, but there's some baseline where you have to sort of say, okay, I can't do that with this product because it's...
Your mind, I swear. If I could get a chance to speak with your group, or there are a lot of possibilities in there. There's so many possibilities. And you have to realize that they have technologies that help them. Not just going in and they have refreshable braille displays, they have screen readers, they have things that can enlarge text. There's all kinds of these technologies that help them.
So you take your product and you adapt it to work with something that's on top. That
yes.
Makes it accessible.
Yeah. And that's the issue modality that you brought up. So we experience things in different modes of understanding. So the written language becomes synthesized text, for example. We can even make tactile representations of things like math, equations and charts and graphs. We can build them in like almost like a 3D space for an accommodation as well. There's so many quite open in that space.
I think for, I'm looking at sort of that as an autism perspective.
Sure.
Autism, of course, is a spectrum, right? You're talking about, so you have very low function, you have very high function, you have kids who are on the spectrum who could come to Princeton, you have kids like my son who probably can't. But I think in terms of, for them, in terms of future and technology, accessibility is like an extremely important issue because even kids who are lower functioning, if the technology is there and the accessibility is there, it could open them up to doing things that they probably couldn't possibly do on the, it gives them more, independence. And I think in those situations, it's even, you have to think of more things because even if you had basics and you're talking about writing for a fourth grade level, or something that is second grade level, maybe. So it's like you're talking also about visual cues and different, it's like my perspective on this is there's still like a long way to come. It's
sure.
Different at, at a
yeah.
university or if you're a corporation or something, but there's so many ways that digital accessibility, whether it's for ordering food from a delivery service from ShopRite or online or this, or it's, in terms of all of these things can actually use the example of a sliding door, it can
yeah.
really open a door for tons of people.
There are technologies too for people with cognitive differences. Read, Write, Gold, Proloquo, things that will sit on top of content if you designed it correctly. So if you put an image, you have a scanned document, throw it up there on your website. Wine can't see that. Looks like people can't enjoy that. And then people with cognitive issues won't be able to have their technologies interact with them either. Right? So there are technologies that will help you read text by taking away all the clutter on the page. We'll just strip it out so it's just large text. It's white text on black background. You can have it speak aloud to you. You can pause it, play it, replay it, and then you can have images come up and vocabulary and glossary. All these things are available with those technologies if you design the content accessibly. If you don't, then all those things are different. And it is 10:52, so if you have to go to another session. And thank you guys so much for your time and your participation today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.